Cilumba. Cilumba.
Yayasan Galu may be one of the saddest places on earth. Located in Bekasi on the outskirts of Jakarta, it's a facility for the mentally ill where some 260 patients spend their days on a hard tile surface rimmed by open sewers. Dozens are locked in a large cage. Others are chained to poles. Many are naked. The air is thick with their weeping and screaming, and with the stench of human excrement in the intense heat. The conditions may seem cruel, but employees at the foundation see themselves as healers who give these much-neglected patients ancient and what they say are effective therapies. Many of the patients have been left here by family members at wit's end, not sure where to turn for help when the choices are so few.
In a country of almost 240 million people, there are only 500 psychiatrists. So into that enormous vacuum left by the near total absence of clinics, occupational therapy, and modern drugs moves traditional medicine, a combination of massage, prayer, and herbal therapy.
During our visit, a traditional healer prayed over chain used to restrain a patient. Herbs were made into eye drops and a drink made from coconuts. Jajat Sujarat, one of the leaders at the foundation, says these traditional healing medicines treat people who suffer from dark spirits.
It's because of a problem in their house or a problem in their family.
So these people have a spiritual sickness, not a physical sickness?
They have a spiritual problem because physically they are in good shape, but it's in their heart, it's in their spirit that they are sick.
It's a common sentiment, not only in Indonesia, but in much of the developing world in general, that mental illness isn't a neurological disorder, but instead is the result of evil spirits. It's a misconception the country's mental health director, Dr. Irmansyah, is trying desperately to change.
What's the biggest problem facing Indonesia in treating its mental health problems today?
Ignorance by the people. You know, some member of our population still believe about superstitious and other things. They don't have any idea that this kind of behavior is a cause of brain malfunction.
Harvard-trained, Dr. Irmansyah has begun a crusade of sorts to educate people about mental illness. We followed him as he went about his work in a village outside Cianjur. We met a 29-year-old man who's been locked up by his family for more than 10 years. According to Dr. Irmansyah, some 30,000 mentally ill people are restrained in cages, stocks, or chains. This man's brother and sister say it's to prevent him from wandering off, frightening neighbors, and getting into trouble. Dr. Irmansyah has convinced them their brother needs to be on medicine for schizophrenia instead. And he's brought along a living example, someone with a powerful story to tell. 2.5 years ago, Nurhamid Karnatmaja went to his local health clinic in Cianjur to seek treatment because he knew something was wrong.
I have bipolar, which means I suffer from two extremes of emotions. I would cry when I was laughing and laugh when I was crying. But that was a long time ago. Now I am healed.
Once you got the proper treatment, were you better quickly?
Yeah.
Yes, I feel so much better now. My emotions are stable. I feel better than even before I was ill.
Nurhamid now volunteers for the clinic as an outreach worker, visiting homes where mentally ill people are being restrained by their families and telling them there's a better way. A year ago, he discovered Kikin Sodikin, who was locked up by his family when he began showing signs of schizophrenia.
My family was very afraid, very worried. They had to restrain me in a cage for 3 months.
Nurhamid introduced Kikin to Dr. Shafari Soma, who developed the Mental Health Community Outreach Program and who provides psychological services at the Cianjur Clinic 2 days a week. Dr. Shafari is a psychiatrist, and he knows there aren't enough doctors like him. In fact, the World Health Organization estimates that Indonesia needs 10 times the psychiatrists it currently has. To make up for some of that deficit, Dr. Shafari is training others to help out.
That is why we are working with other professionals, like nurses. Also, we are training the families of the patients, and we're training former patients. It's the key to the wellness of the patients, and it's proven that it's working here in Cianjur.
While Dr. Shafari is pleased with the results he's been getting with his community medicine project, he's frustrated the government doesn't provide more resources.
A very small amount of money is allocated because they don't think mental illness is the same as physical illness. We want the government to know that it is. Patients need to be treated the same, and mental health doctors need the budgets to treat people with medicines.
Dr. Enggang Rahayu Serinangish is Indonesia's health minister. She agrees mental health is a major problem, but says she's faced with a wide variety of health issues that need funding.
It is not easy. We have limited money. The health budget is only 2.3% from the total national budget. So very small. And everything is important. So we are trying our best, try to balance our budget with the problems.
In fact, only 1% of that limited health budget is spent on mental health. Dr. Enggang says the UN's Millennium Development Goals don't stress mental health, so there's little incentive to spend more among nations straining to meet the targets.
We as country are not valued or judged at the end of 2015 by mental health. So you must understand, also if Minister of Health in other countries do not spend the money there because the indicators are not there.
It's a problem that Harvard medical anthropologist Byron Good sees the world over. Issues like HIV and infant mortality get most of the attention and most of the money.
One of the reasons that mental illnesses tend not to show up on public health statistics is because many people have a chronic illness that doesn't kill them. So if you're using primarily mortality statistics, you find infants and maternal mortality to be a much more dramatic problem. As we've begun to move toward NCDs, non-communicable diseases, then people begin to measure years of life with disability, et cetera. And to everybody's surprise, when they began to measure disability and years of life with disability, mental illnesses came right up to the very top, made up 3 or 4 of the top 10 most disabling illnesses.
4 years ago, Good studied mental health needs in Aceh, the war-torn region in the northern part of the country, hit by a devastating tsunami in 2004. Many survivors suffered severe mental and emotional side effects. He says those disabling mental illnesses have economic consequences.
We ask over 1,000 people, before you got ill, how many hours a week on the average did you work? Young people to old people, average 28 hours a week that I worked in the fields, etc. When you got sick with this mental illness, how many hours could you work? It dropped down to 10 hours. That says to me that there's an enormous economic cost.
In a country urgently seeking to grow its economy, Health Minister Enggang says industry should invest in health services if it wants a productive workforce.
We understand that the health development cannot be done only by the government and cannot be done only by the Minister of Health. So we include all stakeholders. We ask participation from industries, from civil society, as well as from the community themselves.
In the meantime, Drs. Irman Shah and Shafari will continue their work of educating people about the benefits of modern medicine. It's their hope that by 2014, Indonesia will be rid of places like Yayasan Galu and all cages and stocks that restrain the mentally ill.